my dear colleagues, sir. Thank you for the valuable time and I'm presenting a case. She's a 17-year female, presented, she's a second by birth order, born to an unconsanguineous marriage, resident of Kompally, hailing from Vanaparthi, Telangana district, Telangana state, sir. So the parents being parents are the informant being reliable, they presented with a history of worsening cyanosis since last 2 years, and there was a history of cyanotic spells since the 6 months of age. There is a history of shortness of breathing since childhood and worsening since last 2 months of age. There is a history of chest pain since last 2 weeks. These are the chief complaints. So as the history has begun from the birth, I would like to start my history from birth. The girl born to a full-term cesarean delivered baby with a 2.5 kg birth weight and cried. There was no significant antenatal or postnatal events, and very specifically, there was no cyanosis at the neonatal age.
What may be the cause? What are the causes for cyanosis at birth?
Sir, cyanosis at birth during the neonatal age could be because of the worst one most important common cause cyanotic congenital abscess.
Dasagara garu, hello, hello, am I audible?
Yeah, you are audible.
Yes, you are audible.
First, we'll allow the student to tell the history. Then
okay, sure.
And each sentence, if you don't mind.
Let you complete the history and then we will see.
Sure. Sir, am I audible there?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Fine.
So, a mother noticed that cyanosis and cyanotic spells on excessive crying since the 6 months of age. There is a history of excessive crying associated with the deepening of cyanosis, and which was associated with the increased work of breathing, lasted for only 30 to 60 minutes, subsides with sleeping, feeding, and episodes were self-limiting, sir, not requiring any hospitalization during the episodes. Baby evaluated at cardiac center with the echocardiogram at the age of 1 year and were diagnosed to have a cyanotic congenital heart disease. Parents were counseled for the high risk of any high risk for any kind of interventions in view of small age and weight. Parents last to follow up due to social reasons. However, as a child grows, the cyanotic spell episodes were decreased in the frequency. Cyanosis episodes were decreased, but cyanosis has been increased since last 2 years of duration, sir, that is at 15 years of age. Parents also noticed that there was a history of shortness of breathing on walking 500 meters and regular work, unaccustomed work, used to relieve with rest and squatting, which started at 4 to 5 years of age. Dyspnea was grade 2 at the beginning, which was insidious onset, slowly progressive. Presently, child is having dyspnea on even a routine, regular accustomed work since last 2 months. Child studied school till 9 months, 9th standard, left since last 2 years, limits herself for a heavy exercise and sports activity at school. At 11 years of age, that is at 2014, child evaluated at a care hospital, undergone cardiac cath study and angiogram, and as well as CT pulmonary angiogram, counseled for a high risk surgery and advised to take a second opinion from other centers. In 2018, a child attained menarche, that is at 15 years of age, and there is a significant history that there was a prolonged menstrual bleeding for 8 to 10 days, and there is a history of irregular menses. In 2019, again the child evaluated with CT angiogram and advised for high risk, but parents denied for the same. So presently, at right now, child has presented with the worsening cyanosis, and there is a worsening shortness of breathing since last 2 to 3 months. There is a history of chest pain, which is intermittent, which was associated with regular work, aggravated with minimal work, and relieved with rest. There is no associated hematemesis or hemoptysis associated with chest pain, sir. There is no history of abdominal swelling, lower limb swelling, abdominal pain. No history of orthopnea, PND. There is no history of feeding difficulty in the infancy, failure to thrive, or recurrent LRTIs during her No history suggestive of brain abscess. No history suggestive of infective endocarditis. No history of hematemesis or hemoptysis. Developmentally, there was an initial motor delay which attained over a period of time and by 5 years. And she goes to school, averages in studies, and avoids herself for the heavy work. Immunization was complete as per the IAP schedule, and the last vaccine was received at 10 years. Personal history, except a menstrual excessive bleeding, there is no any significant history, sir. They belong to the lower class for Kukusomi classification. This is my end of the history, sir.
Any of the examiners would like to ask questions, clarifications?
Just to let him summarize, because this okay. Summarize very brief.
Yeah, it's a 17-year-old girl, adolescent girl. The history of synotic spell begin at the infancy, progressed over a time, and with the worsening of synosis and shortness of breathing since last 2 years.
Yeah.
The synotic spells were self-limiting.
Yeah, they're fine. That is one.
Sir.
Just to summarize. In 3 sentences.
Right, sir. So, yeah. A 17-year adolescent girl presenting with synotic spell and episodes of squatting episodes. And there is a worsening of synosis.
Yeah.
And worsening of shortness of breathing.
So progressive breathlessness, progressive cyanosis, and spells in early childhood. That
exactly.
is one group of symptoms.
Yes,
second, chest pain. You have said chest pain.
Yes, sir. There is a history of chest pain, which has onsetted in last 2 months.
Okay. Third is negative thing is, what is the negative thing?
There is no history of heart failure during
the history of heart failure and delayed milestones.
Delayed milestones, yes, sir. Initial okay. delayed milestones.
Then detailed evaluation?
Examination, sir.
Detailed evaluation was done earlier?
Yeah. The detailed evaluation was done during her early childhood at 4 years and 10 years. Found to have a synotic congenital heart disease with a complex morphology. And advised for the high risk surgical or any intervention, sir.
Before that, there was one clue. What was the investigation advice in the first setting? CT pulmonary angiogram.
CT pulmonary angiogram, sir. Exactly.
These are the important things. With these things, you can discuss.
Yes, sir. So,
Kalyan, can you just summarize the natural history? You gave a history of 17 years duration, right from the birth. Can you just tell what is the natural history of this this particular disease which is, she has?
Sir, with respect to the history, I feel that there is a synotic congenital heart disease with a decreased pulmonary blood flow. Predominantly, I suspect a VHDPS physiologic conditions where the natural history of the disease will be threatening, and they will have a mortality of almost 60 to 70% by 10 years of first decade.
Yeah, you go ahead.
What are the... See, you told ki VHDPS physiology. What are the causes for the synosis at birth? Which are the diseases which present at the synosis at birth? This specifically you told the synosis start at the age of 6 months. What
yes,
the
sir.
Parents notice?
Yes, synosis at infancy can be because of detransposition of great vessels, sir.
No, infancy is different. Infancy is the long
time. No, neonatal age.
Okay, neonatal age or at birth. Okay.
Yes, sir. At birth. The synosis at birth or neonatal age, early neonatal age is because of the detransposition of great vessels, either with intact septum and obstructed TMPVC, sir, hypoplastic left heart, sir.
So in general, what we'll tell, usually whenever the synosis is there, which is present at birth, it's all complex condition. Single ventricle, tricuspid, TGA or the TOF. VSDPS with the severity like pulmonary atresia VSD with duct dependent circulation, hypoplastic right heart syndrome. This is the typical after 6 months. So this is known as the deferred synosis.
Yes, sir.
Why, if you are thinking it's a VSD PS physiology, why cyanosis is deferred here? Why it happened after 6 months, not before?
Sir, in cases usually the cyanosis appear by second to third month. Top reasons. First reason is that fetal hemoglobin, which has a high carrying oxygen capacity. And second, the neonatal age, the hemoglobin will be more.
How does it
there is tetralogy. We have a tetralogy is a progressive disease with the progressive infundibular and valvular stenosis, which leads to the more obstruction and right to left shunt and worsening of the cyanosis at a later stage.
Any other?
Now, why she is having other symptoms in terms of dyspnea? You are telling that she has got edema, puffiness, all those things. What does the natural history actually say?
Yeah, yes, sir. In the late presenting tetralogies, they can present with the heart failure symptoms.
Now, what will happen to the chronic cyanosis in the system on the heart? What is the effect of chronic hypoxemia on the myocardium?
Hypoxic cardiomyopathy is very well known, sir, and they can present with the heart failure secondary to the hypoxic cardiomyopathy and ventricular dysfunction.
You have one more question here. In the panelist, Swamaraju sir is asking you, sir, why second opinion was taken after advising surgery. Would you like to answer?
Yes, sir. The morphology was, I feel that the morphology was severe enough and more complex, and it was not a easy, it carries a high risk for the surgery. So
very simple. So whenever you feel that it is a high risk for surgery, it's always mandatory to take the second opinion.
And what is the aim for doing the CT angio? That also give you ki why you advise second opinion. And why it's a complex
it is. Absolutely, sir. Because the hypoplastic branch pulmonary artery is in a condition of tetralogy or a VSD PS physiology will definitely certainly makes it a higher.
No, that is the one thing. Second thing, she's grown up. What is the aim for doing the CT angio and cath for that again? What is the other cause?
To delineate the pulmonary artery tree. To check for the collaterals, sir, associated collaterals, and also see for the coronaries which are crossing the right ventricular outflow tract.
But at this age, may not match, huh? But the collaterals are the very significant. It may be more collateral, or it may be small hypoplastic branch PA, so that you want to delineate how that lungs are getting supplied. So that's what it's a okay.
Dr. Nageshwara Garu, can I ask a question? Hello. Hello?
Sir, please ask
the
question.
See, initially patient had, to the candidate, initially patient had spells. Then
yes, there
was a big spell-free period. Again, started getting spell. How will you demonstrate that, or how will you explain that?
Sir, the natural history again...
don't talk about now. In this patient, now patient is in front of you. You got the history story. You tell in this patient. Don't talk about theory now. Come to practice. What is your explanation?
There will be a worsening of RVOT obstruction, progressive increase in the RVOT obstruction, there could be a chances of squatting episodes. But as a child gets older, child also learns to get out of the episodes of spells. So the baby usually comes over with squatting, or he learns over to become a squat so that the episodes become less significant and severe.
That is one explanation. The other explanation is patient develops collaterals by the time 2 years of age. And when the child grows, these collaterals may not be sufficient to give enough oxygenated blood. That is the reason, again, there can be a rebound spells when the child grows.
Okay. I have a doubt because the child learns to avoid spells. That is not happy because spell is not under his control. That's the explanation given by the student. I find it difficult to accept the explanations. I have not thought about this thing. There is spells disappearing and spells appearing later.
It has been given
because the mechanism of spell is entirely different. That is a problem. I can understand the worsening of the symptoms as the child grows, but spells I'm hearing for the first time. There is spell appearing later.
Okay. Sir, it has been mentioned, sir, that there can be a spell-free period when there is collateralization, the bronchopulmonary collaterals develop.
Yeah.
And as the child grows to the adult, the there can be reappearance. It has been. And
what can happen is acute thing can happen when there is a, suppose the child had a PDA gets abruptly closed, or collaterals getting occluded by thrombosis, all those things, worsening can occur. Okay, spells, okay, fine. I have a question commonly asked, why the cyanosis is delayed? The first answer given is the presence of fetal hemoglobin. Is that not applicable to all cyanotic anemia heart disease? Why it is unique for tetralogy of Fallot? This fetal hemoglobin is there in all children. Now, yes, this is the answer which we have taught the students, and people go on answering. There is the high fetal hemoglobin is causing the delayed cyanosis. So that should be applicable to all congenital cyanotic heart disease. Is there any difference in the fetal hemoglobin concentration of patient with tetralogy of Fallot versus the other things? Any idea about that to the panelist also? So that's the answer given by everybody.
It is one of the reason for...
Then why it is applicable to tetralogy? Why it is not applicable to other conditions?
Sir, it depends.
If you know the answer, answer. Otherwise, I say, I don't know. My question is, why this is different? In tetralogy of Fallot, this is applicable, but this is not applicable to other conditions. Why that difference? Well, that is the first answer which all of us taught you and which all the students are telling us. So, why it is unique for tetralogy of Fallot or TOF-like physiology? Okay. Panelist, pediatric, anybody can answer that? The second is the child outgrowing the...
fetal hemoglobin per se doesn't cause only delayed cyanosis, sir. That is one small mechanism.
Yeah, but that's the first thing which is
given. Other things like bronchial collator, accessory pulmonary blood flow, ductus arteriosus, physiological anemia of infancy, and vulnerability of respiratory system and dynamicity of the infant bloom. So,
okay, those things agree. Those things agree. The child is outgrowing that thing, the obstruction is increasing. The ductus may close later, which has been there. Okay, fine.
Please go ahead, sir.
Fine. You can go ahead.
Any drug history is there? Anything? What she is taking, not taking?
No, sir. Actually, drug history, child was not on any medication, sir.
Okay.
So, just a one line summary of your clinical case at the end of the history. Can you please do that?
For me or to the student?
Student.
Okay.
It's a 17-year-old presenting with a history of cyanotic spells and cyanosis since infancy. I am now presented with a worsening of cyanosis and heart failure since last 2 years of age.
Just I will ask one question. The whole thing is out. One question, can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you. Go ahead.
What is regarding the natural history, sir was asking, but you should tell what are the causes of heart failure in a cyanotic congenital heart disease.
Sorry, sir, I could not hear your.
Causes of the child has developed congestive heart failure. What are the possibilities?
You I think you put off your phone, then you can concentrate on the question. Sir, ask a question. What are the causes for heart failure in cyanotic congenital heart disease?
We have discussed about the hypoxic myocardial dysfunction, all those things. But what are the causes for heart failure? Suppose this child, as the child grows, develop heart failure. What are the possibilities? Usual question that is asked, because you will take it in the exam oriented also.
Yes, sir.
Obviously, you are a postgraduate in pediatric cardiology.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Okay, fine. But we'll take it for the whole postgraduates.
Sir, causes of heart failure in cyanotic congenital heart disease, especially in VHD, PS physiologies are multiple, sir. Most common causes could
be... No, you take causes of congestive heart failure in cyanotic heart disease.
Yes, sir. Yeah. One thing is like cyanotic congenital disease itself, like if it is lesser than secondary to increased pulmonary blood flow, the heart failure can be there.
So the first is cyanotic congenital disease, the increased pulmonary blood flow as heart failure in the early infancy. Okay, fine. Then
anemia, which can lead to exacerbation of the failure symptoms, sir.
Then you say heart failure depending on the natural history of the various things. And then you say tetralogy of failure, like physiology, what are the causes of heart failure in later period? The high flow group, when they develop pulmonary hypertension, what can happen? Like that, you have to discuss. Then the third is, which are the groups where the RV dysfunction is more common? The next group is, which are the groups where arrhythmias can happen? So there are certain heart diseases with separate mechanisms, and there are certain common mechanisms, as you have said, like the patient developing infection, anemia, can precipitate heart failure in any situation. Yes. But if you take infancy, heart failure in a high flow group. Later, depending on the subset, whether it is a high flow with pulmonary hypertension, then low flow group, then arrhythmogenic situations, RV dominance situation, like that. Like that, you can proceed and find out multiple causes for heart failure. And based on that, when do they develop heart failure, also you can discuss. That will be a better approach to give the answer for the examination. Okay. Let's take back tetralogy of failure, like physiology, developing heart failure, or classical tetralogy will take developing heart failure. What are the situations? You find a 17-year-old boy with tetralogy of failure developing, or 30-year-old patient developing heart failure. Like that, you discuss. What are the conditions you think of?
General conditions like anemia,
okay,
pallor. Second is infective endocarditis, sir.
Yeah.
Then if it is significant collaterals, large collaterals, again leading to pulmonary increased pulmonary blood flow and causing a heart.
Very if it comes low in the list.
That could be there. Yes, sir. That could be there since beginning only. And patient, if the shunt is overflowing, then also the patient can present with a heart failure in a case of TPS.
Tetralogy of failure, you start like that. Okay, general thing, anemia, you said, you should say tetralogy of failure with hypertension, tetralogy of failure with aortic regurgitation, then tetralogy of failure, as the child progresses, what happens? They can develop arrhythmias, they can develop RV dysfunction, postoperative tetralogy of failure. Then you can say excessive pulmonary blood flow due to multiple mechanisms. Okay. And natural history, you can say chronic hypoxic myocardial dysfunction. That is the way you can put all the possibilities. Infective endocarditis, obviously, you should not forget. Okay. Fine. Postoperative, you should know.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Postoperative, also the mechanisms they will ask you.
There is a question from one of the students that myocarditis he wrote. So what are the causes for ventricular dysfunction in an unoperated tetralogy of Fallot in an adult like this? What are the causes for ventricular dysfunction?
Most common condition that we see is because of the prolonged hypoxemia, cyanosis. The second, hypoxic cardiomyopathy, is the one which we should think first. And second can be because of...
That question can be answered like this. The question is very specific, ventricular dysfunction.
Ventricular dysfunction. One is hypoxic cardiomyopathy. Very well, you have been talking that. Can you please tell other causes?
If there are the significant collaterals, then volume overload to the left ventricle leading to ventricular dysfunction.
Okay, but it is...
Yes, sir. Third subset could be associated significant AVVR, like mitral regurgitation.
No, what about intercurrent viral myocarditis?
Yes, sir.
What about coronary embolism? If you have hypoxemia, is it possible to have coronary embolism and myocardial dysfunction?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Because one student asked, I am just asking you. Okay. Please go ahead, no problem.
I got a couple of questions to the candidate. Yes, can I ask?
Please, sir.
You mentioned that patient hails from some Pumpalli. Is there any reason why you mentioned the place from where patient is coming? Has it got any bearing in cyanotic congenital heart disease?
Not exactly, sir. I just wanted to give the address of the patient.
No, there is relevance. Patients stay in high altitude can develop pulmonary edema much earlier. Pulmonary hypertension much earlier. So it has got a relevance, particularly patient coming from Kulu, Manali, and other places. They can develop pulmonary hypertension much earlier in a case of shunt. So it has got relevance, but you could not correlate. I got one more question. In patient of Gutch means grown up congenital heart disease, Gutch. What are the causes of hemoptysin cyanotic congenital heart disease? You have mentioned correctly, there is no hemoptysis, there is no hematemesis. Sometimes these children will swallow the sputum and they can have hematemesis like type of picture also. So what are the causes of hemoptysis in Gutch?
Secondary to rupture of bronchial vessel, sir.
Anything else?
In our condition, it can be secondary to even collateral ruptures. The long history of long-standing collaterals can have chances of getting ruptured or getting stenosis. So even that can lead to hemoptysis.
In cases of increased pulmonary flow, these children are more prone for LRTI. So one of the commonest causes is LRTI.
Okay.
Patients with oligemic lung fields, that is hypoperfused lungs, they are prone for cox. So many children, they develop cox, another cause of hemoptysis. Third is patients who are deeply cyanotic, they can have recurrent pulmonary thromboembolism into small vessels. So they can have at later date, they can develop with mild elevation of pulmonary pressures also. So recurrent pulmonary thromboembolism because of increased hematocrit is another cause. Last, of course, you told me bronchopulmonary collateral rupture and the aortopulmonary collateral. They are usually more than moderate hemoptysis, but these are more common causes in Gutch.
Add two more points. One, cyanotic congenital disease, many of them will have coagulation abnormalities. Third, right side endocarditis leading to embolization to the pulmonary vasculature. And as sir said, in situ thrombosis.
In situ
thrombosis.
And when they develop pulmonary hypertension, usually PA pressure won't go to that classified 20 millimeters. Otherwise also in tetralogy like situation, the mean PA pressure is 10. Even if it goes to 20, that it shows by doing catheter, by echo, that shows that there is some amount of restrictive lung disease or some amount of elevation of pulmonary hypertension, pulmonary artery pressure. This can even happen with large shunt cases. The PA pressure, it won't go to the adult level like 25 and above mean PA pressure. There's one important hemodynamics should remember.
Please go ahead, Kalyan, with the subsequent presentation. So at the end of history, do you have any differential diagnosis?
Yes, sir. At the end of my clinical history, I would think that it's a cyanotic congenital heart disease which has decreased pulmonary blood flow, VHD PS physiology with a complex morphology, without evidence of infective endocarditis, but presented with the worsening heart failure symptoms. Differential diagnosis I would like to think is VHD with pulmonary stenosis or pulmonary atresia with a hypoplastic branch pulmonary arteries or a collateral dependent pulmonary blood flow. As a first differential diagnosis.
How can you tell that it is a hypoplastic branch pulmonary arteries and collateral dependent blood flow? That is a morphological diagnosis which can be detected only by CT angio or by angiogram. But at the end of the history, if you are telling this, is a bit doubtful for me.
Sir, child had undergone CT scan two times before, and they have been labeled. They have been mentioned that it's a high risk for any kind of surgical or intervention, sir.
So but you can tell only now VSD pulmonary atresia collateral dependent, hypoplastic, mm-hmm. Absent. It may be absent also.
Yes, sir. That true, sir. Collateral dependent pulmonary blood.
Your differential diagnosis 1 and 2, you can't differentiate because basically you are going for a tetralogy of allophysiology. Okay.
Yes,
So you can put two or three or four conditions, but that common thing. Now you have put AV canal defect with BSD PS. Basically, sir, why do you prefer that? Why did you put that AV canal defect specifically? This also comes as VSD PS.
Yes, sir.
With a severe, what is AVVR?
Atrial ventricular AV valve, sir. AV valve regurgitation.
AV valve regurgitation. Why do you want to bring in AV valve regurgitation here? What is the clue that there is severe AV valve regurgitation?
Child has presented with the heart failure symptoms right now, sir.
Right, sir. Same thing. It's almost the same thing.
Yes.
There may be other causes also, no? What sir told you for the heart failure. You can't.
Yes, sir.
All these things are there common.
In fact,
if you see the embryology, in AV canal defects, pulmonary stenosis is very, very, very rare. It is pulmonary hypertension which is more common. You will have an ASD, VSD, MR, TR combination, PAH. But not PS is very, very rare.
If you see, Alain, are you ruling out other causes of VST PS physiology? Can you please table what are the VST PS physiology?
VST PS physiology with right ventricular dominance or classical tetralogy of Fallot or VST pulmonary atresia, DORV VST pulmonary stenosis or pulmonary atresia. The VSD PS with the left ventricular dominance can be tricuspid atresia with VSD pulmonary stenosis, single ventricle with pulmonary stenosis, and even AV canal with significant.
How are you ruling out single ventricle PS, tricuspid atresia VSD PS, or DTJ VSD PS in this condition by history alone?
Sir,
with history we can't.
It is difficult, sir. But in cases of DTGA or DTGA VSDPS, the cyanosis would have been more earlier in occurrence rather than 6 months of age. That was what I was.
And if you take natural history of DTGA VSDPS, they don't survive this year of age group. 17 years. Manivannan wrote here. I am just seeing that. Surviving 17 years with not much of cyanosis. Cyanosis is very dominant even in infancy them. So it comes under low priority. Is it CTJ VSTPS?
Yes, it could be.
What is the cyanosis in CTJ VSTPS? Most of the cases. Common natural history of CTJ VSTPS.
In CCTJ VSTPS, sir, it is always optimal pulmonary blood flow and they have a degree cyanosis. They don't have significant cyanosis as compared to the other subsets.
It's not clear to me. What did you say? CTJ VSTPS, what about cyanosis compared to classical tetralogy?
The apparent cyanosis can be milder, sir.
Why?
Because of the optimal pulmonary blood flow.
Pulmonary stenosis is the same thing. Depends on the degree of pulmonary stenosis.
But why CTJ will have lesser cyanosis compared to other VST PS physiology?
Because the streaming of the blood in CTJ VST PS.
CTJ VST PS will have favorable streaming. Most of the pulmonary venous return will go to the aorta. Most of the systemic venous return will go to.
That's a point which he has to highlight. Now, basically, you are thinking of a low flow group of various subsets, difficult to differentiate. Earlier cyanosis may indicate a more complex thing. Now, whenever you get a cyanotic angina disease, one of the things you should not miss is Epstein's anomaly. For completion's sake, I will discuss, though it may not be the case. You have to consider whenever you get tetralogy of Fallot like physiology, in the absence of the heart failure in infancy and developing heart failure later, especially right heart failure, as you have said, then you have to think of Epstein's anomaly also. Is it likely to be Epstein's? You can contradict.
Sir, Epstein's
condition which you have to consider in any case of cyanotic without heart failure in infancy. Yes. Can it be Epstein's?
Yes, sir. The Epstein's has a bimodal clinical presentation.
Bimodal or triphasic? What is this bimodal?
Sir, in the neonatal age, the baby presents with heart failure and with high neonatal PVR. Usually they will present with a significant cyanosis and heart failure symptoms at an
Next is
and as the neonatal PVR falls down during the as the child grows, the significant regurgitation starts begins in, and they can tolerate tolerate the condition, sir.
At so the PVR rate, drops. So yes, what sir. Happened to the cyanosis, right to left shunt? What happens?
It will decrease, sir.
And then later.
Later on, in adolescent age group, they can present with chronic right ventricular volume overload condition.
Right heart failure. They can develop cyanosis again. So basically, I think it is a triphasic response. Cyanosis with symptoms in the immediate or early neonatal period, the child improves. Later again, the patient develops cyanosis and symptoms and heart failure. Okay. So here the patient had cyanosis. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Pain like that, and later developing heart failure with worsening cyanosis. But what is less likely? What is the point to say that this is unlikely to be Epstein's in the history?
There is a history of cyanotic spells.
Cyanotic spells. You can say that cyanotic spells is not a feature of Epstein's anomaly. But what else will be there in the history to say that this could be Epstein's?
If the episodic palpitation, history of episodic palpitation.
History to suggest tachyarrhythmias. Okay, very good.
Can I proceed, sir?
Yeah.
Yeah. Please go ahead with the clinical examination.
Examination. Child is thin built, moderately nourished, sick looking girl. Child is on oxygen, conscious, irritable, but oriented to time place person. She appeared syndromic in appearance and has a forehead. There is a wide nasal bridge and there was a high neckline, sir. Vitals, she was afebrile for touch, sir. Pulse rate was 110 per minute, regular, normal in volume, normal in character, no evidence of radioradial or radiofemoral delay. There was a tachycardia. Respiratory rate was 30 per minute, normal abdominothoracic type of breathing. There was a mild intercostal retractions. There was a tachypnea as well, sir. Saturations were 66% in right upper limb at room air, 68% at right lower limb, sir. BP was 114 by 68 millimeter of mercury at right upper limb at supine position, 120 systolic 120 millimeter of mercury at systolic in right lower limb, sir. General physical examination, JVP was elevated 4 centimeter above the clavicle with a prominent A wave at which was examined at 45 degree inclination. Sinuses noted at oral cavity, lips as well as peripheral limbs. Pan digital clubbing grade 2 is present, sir. Pallor is there, sir. Pedial edema was not there, sir. Sorry, it was a mistake. Scoliosis was there on the right side. Oral caries is there in the right lower molar teeth. There is no evidence of icterus lymphadenopathy. There is no evidence of peripheral signs of infective endocarditis. Cardiovascular examination. Apical impulse is situated at fifth intercostal space along the midclavicular line, which is diffuse in nature. RV type of apex is there. Mild precordial bulge on the left side. There is no parasternal heave. There is a palpable S3 was present, sir. No thrill, scar, sinus, venous engorgements. Percussion wise, gastric tympani is on the left side and hepatic dullness was on the right side. Left border corresponding to the apex, sir. Right border was retrosternal. Second intercostal space was resonant. Heart sounds, auscultation. First heart sound was normal, sir. Second heart sound was single and loud. I felt it's an IoT component. LVS3 is present at the apex, sir. There is no evidence of ejection clicks or other adventitious sounds. There is a continuous murmur heard at the infraclavicular, axillary, interscapular region, which is 2 by 4 in grade, soft, high frequency murmur with no variation in the respiration.
Just some points to be clear. Okay, go ahead.
Lungs are, there is air entry is clear. There are no adventitious sounds. per abdomen, the soft non-tender, sir, no liver was present. This completion of my exam.
Now, I want to clarify some of the findings. So can you start with the first slide? Some points to be clarified. Okay.
Sure, sir.
Findings. Okay.
Yes, sir.
That's okay. Next one. Next slide. Okay. Next slide. Here itself. JVP elevated 4 centimeters above clavicle, we have mentioned. No, JVP. At 45 degrees.
Yes, sir.
At 45 degrees.
Sir.
Now, how will you examine the JVP?
You
have put it as a hybrid now. Because earlier it was 45 degrees with angle of Louis. What is the present recommendation? From the clavicle in sitting position. So the method of examination of the JVP now recommend is, the reference is the root of the clavicle and position is sitting with legs hanging down. The patient was sitting with legs hanging down. So that is not acceptable as per the presenting. 45 degrees we used earlier and it was angle of mandible and all those things. Now it is reference point is clavicle and position is sitting up, legs hanging down with clothes loosened. Okay, next slide. Next slide. Okay. Here the problem is, what is the apex you have said?
RV type of apex. Sir.
What is the C1 you have palpated over the apex bit? LVS3. This doesn't tally.
Sir, yes, sir.
No. By palpation, you can't say whether it is LV or RVS3. Very clear. You have said that the apex is of RV type. That is, the apex is formed by RV. You have mentioned it. Okay. You have mentioned that there is an RV type of apex. Then you, even S3, yes, you can't say whether palpable S3 is not an easy thing. Okay. So that doesn't tally. RV type of apex with LVS3, you should be careful. Now you didn't mention about the parasternal heave. That is a problem which is happening now. Without left parasternal heave, how can you say the LV is of RV and the apex is of RV type? How will you say that the apex is LV or RV type? It is a very difficult thing for me. Even though all of us say it is LV, RV type, to me it is not easy always. But why did you say it is an RV type of apex? Apex means the apex is formed by right ventricle. And there is no left parasternal heave. Okay, there is a disparity there. I am not saying that you have not picked up this finding. To mention that the apex is RV type, the apex is formed by the RV. So from the parasternal region to the apex, there should be something. All you say is retraction, all those things, I don't agree because it is not an easy finding. That the apex is retracting, it is not an easy thing. Second, if you have palpated the apex as an RV type, the third sound which you palpate over that should be RVS3. So that is a contradictory thing. So you should be careful when you go for very finer finding presentations. And the palpable LVS3, you can say there is a early diastolic event palpable. That will be a better thing. Rather than committing that there is a palpable LVS3, sir, there is a palpable early diastolic event or a palpable pre-systolic event. Because you are not palpating the third sound. You are not palpating the fourth sound. You are palpating the apex movement. Then we go back to the apex cardiogram to identify that. So what you are feeling is early diastolic rapid filling movement. And late diastolic atrial contraction producing a pre-systolic impulse. That is a better way of presentation rather than saying third sound. Okay. So don't use RV apex, LV S3. Second,
yes,
S3 you need not mention. You can say there is a palpable third sound over the apex. Okay, next slide.
One more point here.
Is it localized or you cannot palpate the localized apex at all?
Yeah.
Apex. Apical beat palpation. Did you palpate localized apex or you did not palpate?
I felt it was a diffuser.
Is it palpable, first of all, or visible?
It was palpable, sir. It was diffused, actually.
Can I make a comment here?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
See, apex is either RV type, LV type. If you are unable to make out, you see, you're indeterminate. If you have written apex diffuse nature, there's nothing like diffuse apex in any of the books. So you must say indeterminate. You are unable to determine whether RV or LV. Here that the apex diffuse in nature is not acceptable. Another point is, in a cyanotic congenital heart disease, when you are talking about percussion, if at all you are talking, you must always talk about liver dullness, because the situs inversus should be kept in mind. That is also should be mentioned in percussion.
Yes, sir, I mentioned, but I did not kept in the slide.
Okay, just one clarification, because as sir said, apex diffuse, some examiners may use that. But what did you mean when you said apex is diffuse? What is in your mind, or what you have observed? It was felt over the fifth left ventricular space, as well as there is no cardiomegaly, because it is in the midclavicular line.
Yes, sir.
It is in the fifth space. Yes. What was the observation when you said it is diffuse?
Sir, it was continuing from the parasternal area.
No, there is no parasternal heave.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir, there is no parasternal heave. Okay.
Yes.
So you can't say that. So be careful. The statement should be congruous. That is all. You make errors, but even errors should be congruous. So you have to look into that statements. RV type of apex, diffuse apex, no parasternal heave, LVS3. So there is disparity in those statements. So you have to go back, recheck, and refine these statements. Okay. That is what is needed.
Can you go to next slide, please?
Yeah.
Next slide.
Sure.
Next slide.
1 minute.
There again, I have one more thing. Rather than saying LVS3, you say S3 is present, the third sound over the apex.
Yes.
Now, regarding that grade 2/4, this grading of continuous murmur, I don't know.
No, even that is what I want to take objection. Continuous murmurs are never graded. Any continuous murmur is pathologically significant. And systolic may have one gradient, grade, diastolic. And diastolic may have one grade. So there is no grading in continuous murmurs as far as my knowledge goes. That is what I wanted to bring it a point. I agree with Sudhay Kumar, sir.
I am also not sure about the grading of continuous murmur. We say, actually, originally, Levine's classification was systolic murmurs are graded. It started like that. Later, diastolic murmurs, we thought that it need not be graded, but of late, diastolic murmurs are graded up to grade 4. Continuous murmur, I have not read. Okay, go ahead.
I just want to clarify only one aspect. Kalyan, from your side, if you don't have a localized apical impulse, either it is a normal apical impulse, heaving or hyperdynamic, well sustained, well lift or well sustained. So whether the apical impulse is not palpable at all, or you can see only some impulses in diffuse nature.
Yes, sir.
Okay, then only you can call it as RV type of apical impulse. Suppose you have subxified pulsations, subxified heave, then parasternal heave, then probably you will come with a RV hypertension. If you have a pulmonary hypertension, then parasternal heave. So in your clinical presentation, are you going to tell that I have a diffuse RV impulse without parasternal heave, or you are going to tell that I have an apical impulse which you don't know which type of apical impulse? What is your understanding before you go to subsequent part of the analysis?
Sir, actually it was like better seen and also diffuse kind of apex that I felt as like a regular apex.
But what is diffuse actually?
Sir, more than 2 intercostal spaces.
But that means you are able to palpate well, no?
Yes, sir.
Then what sir was telling, ki parasternal heave is not there, and you are able to palpate pulse very well in that one or two spaces. Then
that's the best way in the examination. The best way in the examination is, if you are not sure, don't commit. Let the exam ask questions. Committing creates more problems. So if I am there,
the heart size is normal. I just want to ask a question. What is your definition of apical impulse?
Yeah, I think you better answer that.
Hello?
Yeah, what is your definition of apical impulse?
It's the outermost and lowermost cardiac impulse.
Point of distinct pulsations.
Yes, sir.
So basically, whether you are able to palpate the distinct outward pulsations or not, is it present, not present? If it is present, then you are going to call it as an apical impulse.
Yeah. Outermost and lowermost distinctly
point,
palpable.
Point of distinct pulsations. Basically, that is it. You know, then we have problems about differentiating it, whether it is LV or RV. First thing is that the reason for locating the apical impulse is twofold. Is there a cardiomegaly? No cardiomegaly. If there is a cardiomegaly, is it caused by the ventricular enlargement? If it is caused by ventricular enlargement, is it RV or LV? That is the only idea. But first, you should be able to tell whether cardiomegaly is present or not present by examining the physical. Agreed that we cannot make out all the time.
So can we move on to the subsequent?
Yeah, sure.
But one word of caution, at this point, you should not commit LVS3 or RVS3.
So it makes
a big difference in the discussion and mechanisms. Okay. It's not the usual thing. Okay, go ahead.
Please go ahead with your clinical diagnosis.
Yeah.
It's a situs solitus, leocardia, cyanotic congenital heart disease with a decreased pulmonary blood flow, VHD with pulmonary atresia, collateral dependent pulmonary blood circulation, with a heart failure class 3 in sinus rhythm, and also the no evidence of infective endocarditis, syndromic appearance to rule out Dejerv syndrome.
I think purely from the semantic point of view, you cannot say heart failure NYHA class 3. NYHA class is functional class. Heart failure has got separate classification.
Okay. Now, from that
side, I have transferred the all the imaging to you. Can you please present the image here?
Just one question.
Yeah.
Now, when you, it's this thing, heart failure, you have said.
Yeah.
Commonly right heart failure or left heart failure? And the discussion related to that.
Sir, actually, I felt it was a biventricular dysfunction because there were no symptoms as such specifically suggestive of right ventricular failure or right
ventricular. JVP,
what does JVP suggest?
No, symptoms, sir. Yes, sir.
No, let us conclude. Be very brief. The JVP is elevated, yes, so you think there is right heart failure or systemic venous congestion. Agree?
Yes, sir.
Why did you say left heart failure?
Left heart, I am not sure, sir, because...
But you mentioned LVS3.
Dyspnea and exertion, recent worsening of dyspnea and exertion.
Yes, sir.
And distress.
No, that could be due to worsening cyanosis, right heart failure. Both these things can contribute to worsening your symptoms. But my question is on, because you have every time highlighted palpable LVS3, audible LVS3. What is the mechanism for that?
Sir, the S3 is audible because of it's a diastolic, early diastolic event caused because of the turbulent blood flow.
Why this patient? I'm not talking about the theory of LVS3. In this patient, what is producing that LVS3?
Because of the elevated right ventricular, right atrial pressure, sir. Right ventricular and diastolic pressure.
So you mean to say that it's a large BSD. So when the RV diastolic pressure rises, the LV diastolic pressure also rises. So agreed. But why it is LVS3? what is the situation where you get LVS3 in this? Suppose we get an LVS3.
I will correct myself, sir, because the S3 was there definitely, sir, but it was RVR, LV was not.
Let me put it like this. A third sound indicates that there is a mid-diastolic or mid-diastolic, not the absolutely early diastolic, that is during the rapid filling phase, you are hearing a sound. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
I agree with you that you are hearing it over the left ventricle. What is the likely mechanism in this case or possible mechanism in these types of cases? Increased flow to the left atrium when there is excessive aorta pulmonary collaterals. You said earlier during the history discussion, one of the causes for heart failure is excessive pulmonary blood flow due to PDA or aortic pulmonary collaterals or both. So in such situations, you can have a diastolic event over the apex. Second, a cyanotic congenital disease, you said the AVM is prominent. You have picked up LVS3. What is the likely diagnosis? You have not picked up parasternal heave.
Tricuspid atresia.
Yeah, tricuspid atresia. You have picked up from early cyanosis, prominent A-wave, no left parasternal heave, LVS3, and collaterals are there.
Yes.
So that is one situation. Why don't you entertain tricuspid atresia? I think other panelists also can.
Kalyan, suppose you have a prominent A-wave in a tetralgia fellow, adult tetralgia fellow, where you can have failure in the third decade or fourth decade because of rise in SVR, a prominent A-wave, what does it indicate? Auscultation-wise, Dr. Somarajan sir is asking about it. A prominent A-wave in a JVP, what does it correlate auscultatory event in an adult tetralgia fellow?
S4, sir.
S4. So what will happen over the period of time, right ventricular or biventricular complaints will come down. SVR increases, then they will start developing first prominent AVM, JVP rise, then you will develop a myocardial dysfunction, hypoxic cardiomyopathy, then S3 is possible. Just since the sir asked that question, good to...
Sir, one more thing, sir. What may be the cause for chest pain here, sir? So chest pain also one of the complaint here.
Kalyan, what is the cause for chest pain here?
I'll give you the clue. Is it primarily related to cardiac or a non-cardiac cause? From the description. That is the first thing you have to say. Chest pain description is suggestive of ischemic or a non-ischemic. This thing. That is the first you have to analyze. If it is non-ischemic in a cyanotic, what is the situation you have to think of? Suppose the patient complains of the pain on the right side, which is increasing with inspiration.
That could be secondary to pleuritis or...
Agreed. But we discussed the cause of hemoptysis.
Yes, sir. Collateral rupture of...
It is pleural. When you get chest pain, it is pleural, not parenchymal. Yes. Collaterals are parenchymal.
Yes, sir.
There are pleural collaterals also. A pulmonary thrombosis or pulmonary infarct due to thrombosis or embolism from a vegetation or all those things.
Yeah.
So if this patient complains of chest pain, you have to see whether it's a pleuritic pain, such as your pulmonary embolism, or it may be quite unrelated. It may be, if it is ischemic, you can think of some rare anomalies also. Okay.
The chest pain, as Sudeep is asking you, is it respiratory related or non-related to the exertion? What is the nature of the chest pain here?
Sir, the chest pain, I felt it was like a pulmonary thromboembolic.
What is the
description?
How the chest pain is there? Is it during exertional or non-exertional, first of all?
It was exertional, sir. It was episodic. Lasting for only 30 to 60 minutes, sir. Used to relieve after taking rest.
So, that is how you will tell that it is pleuritic or thromboembolic. In this particular patient who deteriorated recently, you should give importance to that. Sudeep, is it your question? Did he answer your question?
Yes, sir, because what the Sudeep sir also told, whether it's ischemic, non-ischemic, we should know the cause actually, because it's on the exertion, whether it's related to pruritus or related to some coronary event, which is causing sudden appearance, or it's a continuous on exertion.
Yes, sir.
So that gives importance, sir, actually. And suppose it will be mismatch also because it's already dysfunction. So if it works exertion, that also will cause the more discomfort rather than the exactly chest pain, sir.
Suppose there is a isolated right ventricular hypertrophy.
Yeah.
The RV pressures are suprasystemic. Do you get a RV angina?
Yes. It is described in pulmonary hypertension.
Yeah.
And this case, pulmonary RV hypertrophy is already there. And the cardiac output oxygen carrying capacity is low.
Yes.
Oxygen content is low. So they are likely to develop
angina. Kalyan, are you aware of that?
Yeah, that's the thing which you have to look into. So you have to look
whether...
Just now
somebody was discussing about tricuspid atresia.
Yes, sir.
In adults with tricuspid atresia, invariably have LV apex because RV is not there. It's almost
absolutely
like
correct.
So absence of LV apex rules out the possibility of tricuspid atresia in this case.
Yeah. I didn't mean that. I was discussing. He said.
No. I'm just clarifying. I'm not contradicting with you. Giving him a tip.
Yeah.
In adults with tricuspid atresia. Must have LV.
I think a tricuspid atresia single ventricle should have LV apex, which is as per the Kalyan's report, which is not there. Even I examined that there is no apical impulse palpable. Actually, it's a diffuse impulse are seen. We can't palpate apical impulse at all in this particular patient. Suggests that there is no LV apex at all. LV dominance is not there.
So that rules out tricuspid atresia.
I think.
Yes.
We have to move on, please. Yeah. We don't have much. How much time, sir, we have?
Another 15 minutes.
Another 15 minutes. So please go ahead.
Chest X-ray, sir. So it's a PA view showing a situs solitus, levocardia. There is a scoliosis. The sternal vertebra is on deviated on the right side. Cardiothoracic ratio of 60%. Apex could not be made out very clearly, sir. And the pulmonary bay is empty here, sir. And the pulmonary vascularity appears reduced. The pulmonary arteries are not, central pulmonary arteries are not well seen. And chamber enlargement, even though the right atrial enlargement appears there, but it is secondary, maybe because of scoliosis, we may not able to appreciate very well.
So what is the one point which is giving information as per the X-ray concern?
Sir, it is showing a classical tetralogy, like absent pulmonary bay and cardiomegaly.
There is a scoliosis and the expiratory film. Only one point is very clear here. What is that point?
Cardiomegaly is there, sir.
No.
It is reduced vascularity. How can you comment on cardiomegaly when there is a scoliosis and expiratory film?
In situs?
Situs is solitus, sir, as liver shadow is on the right side. Stomach shadow is not very clear.
So what is the important?
Very important finding is reduced vascularity in this X-ray.
Yes, sir.
Go ahead. Next.
And left aortic arch.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, you have to look for the arch. To me, it looks like a left aortic arch.
Yes, sir.
Because these are some of the things we can straight away say. As said, the first is oligemic, cytosolitis, levocardia, and arch. To me, it seems to be on the left side. Okay.
Please go to ECG.
It's a 12-lead ECG with the normal speed, normal standardization, showing.
An ECG of a congenital heart disease like this. Just look for this. What are the things you look for?
Sir, we will see for the QRS axis.
Before that, you have to look for situs.
Yes, sir.
Situs, you have to look for first. Okay. AV conduction, you go systematically. Then the P and the atrial abnormality, whether there is a tall P wave, the PR role you have to look for. Analyze the QRS mainly for the axis and the ventricular dominance.
Yes.
You look for septal vector and try to assess the hemodynamic data. So these are the things which you have to look for. And specifically look for pre-excitation. These are things which you have to look for specifically when you are given an ECG in a
in a cyanotic conjunctival disease. All these things you have to address. Okay.
You please read what are you talking?
Hello?
Can you please read the ECG? We are waiting.
P-wave morphology appears, there is a bilateral enlargement as represented by the tall and wide P-waves in lead 2 and biphasic P-waves in V1. PR interval is normal, 120 milliseconds. QRS axis is plus 60 to 90. Actually, sir, at the ventricular forces, it appears like dominant, both biventricular forces are there, because at V1, there is a prominent tall R waves and there is an acute sudden transition. At V2, there are both R and S waves are almost equal. And V5, V6, there are...
From the ECG, it is LV dominance, RV dominance or biventricular. And you have to support that.
Biventricular.
Which is more dominant in this?
Left ventricle.
So, left ventricle is dominant because?
As evidenced by the tall R waves in lateral chest leads.
And deep S in V6. V1 shows good S wave also.
What is in V1?
Point here. When the patient has got, can I?
Scoliosis.
Then patient has got kyphoscoliosis. The ECG criteria may not be ideal because there is a shift in the cardiac silhouette. So there is severe kyphoscoliosis. First of all, we expected right axis deviation, which is not there in this case. Early transition also doubtful. So the ECG is showing LV forces. How much importance we can give with the underlying kyphoscoliosis must be debated.
Yes, sir. I will just contribute. This is the case where you have to take right sided chest lead. You have to take a V3R, V4R to see RV.
Exactly.
Even if there is this thing, V5, V6, lateral lead showing monophasic RV indicate that the LV is there. Even with kyphoscoliosis, V5, V6 showing very tall RV indicates the LV is there. LV is, this is not what we expect. As you go to the left side, the S wave should become deeper and deeper in pure RVH. Okay. So, sir said is absolutely right that when there is a chest deformity, there are limitations in reading the ECG. Always you have to take right side chest lead to pick up RVH and sudden transition. But that may be there. But the point is the left side chest lead shows monophasic R wave indicating that. And you have to look for a Q wave in V5, V6. Or in the left side lead, when there is a tall R wave in a left side lead, you have to look for a Q wave. For two things. One, if there is a Q wave, it rules out L transmission of great arteries. Second, presence of a Q wave in V5, V6 indicate that there will be volume is on the higher side. Especially important in the cases which you have discussed, the pulmonary collaterals are producing a good flow to the left ventricle. Now there are some other conditions which produce LVH or LV dilatation also.
Dr. Somaraju has raised a very good point. Absence of Q waves in the chest leads should give rise to the suspicion of single ventricle with PS. That is one of the important point he has pointed out, that absence of Q in all the chest leads. Very important point. Another thing is this ECG will rule out the possibility of double outlet right ventricle physiology, because there is no counterclockwise loop. There is no deep S wave. There is no deep S and slurred S waves in V5, V6. So, double outlet right ventricle VSD PSCs can be ruled out from the CCG.
So, current V1, what is R by S in V1?
Yes.
S is dominant.
But we didn't have the early transition as we expect, maybe because of the chest wall deformity.
Maybe we should have taken off standardization to avoid that overlapping.
Exactly.
So, V1, it shows for me R by S, R wave is dominant than S actually.
Yes, agreed.
Just a question to the postgraduate pediatric cardiology. Why in single ventricle Q is absent?
Mm.
Because the commonest type of single ventricle is the situation where the ventricles are inverted. Classically, yes, the single ventricle, the commonest type is with ventricular inversion. And ventricular inversion results in loss of Q waves, just like LTG. Okay.
That is one. Second thing, when their septum is absent, you may not have septal activation. That is another, there may be well-formed, well-morphological two ventricles.
Yeah.
Total septum may be absent where there is no septal activation.
Fine. Yeah.
So in DILV, double inlet left ventricle with the L-mal position great vessel, that is the common one, where the outlet chamber is left and anterior. The so-called bulboventricular septum or foramina is the interventricular septum, may be logical. Since it is very well anterior and left, your Q waves are virtually going to be not seen there. Unless you have a demalposite great vessel where bulboventricular chamber right and anterior, where you will see Q waves in V3R, V4R, even V1 sometimes you will see based on the amount of flow. So by and large, if you don't see that, you have a suspicion that it may be single ventricle.
There is one tip for the PGs. If I'm wrong, correct me, Dr. Nageshwara Garu. AV valves will go with the ventricle, ventricular morphology.
Absolutely correct, sir.
And outflow tract will go with the, what is that called, the aortic valve and pulmonary valve. Outflow tract will go along with the aortic and pulmonary valve.
By definition, a ventricle should have inlet portion and AV valve. If you don't have inlet and AV valve, that is not called as ventricle, that is called as bulboventricular chamber or rudimentary chamber.
Rudimentary chamber.
So, what do you have at the end of X-ray and ECG? What is your summary? There is a cyanotic heart disease
with the decreased pulmonary blood flow and but ECG shows a good ventricle, left ventricular forces. So, the blood flow to the lung should be optimal or normal.
And also there is a biatal enlargement suggestive of
heart failure.
Mm-hmm. Double outlet right ventricle can have this type of LV because the only outflow tract for the left ventricle or posterior ventricle is VSD. So in a double outlet right ventricle VSD PS, you can have LV forces. One of the different diagnoses of tetralogy fellow is DORV VSD PS. But to say that DORV will have a long ejection murmur in the left ventricle, that is the left ventricle, this RV outflow tract murmur will be long. But in your clinical examination, you didn't mention any long murmur. So clinical and ECG is not going hand in hand. But in the ECG, double outlet right ventricle should be thought of when there is LV forces. That is a close difference diagnosis of TOF.
So whenever there is a double outlet right ventricle with a restrictive VST, you will have a long murmur and you will have LV forces. Okay, you go ahead with the other modality. But I want to tell you that whenever there is a continuous murmur, back of the chest, suggestive of collateral, which is the VST, PS physiology, which is commonly associated.
Top pulmonary
atresia, sir. So, tetralogy fellow, pulmonary atresia is commonly associated with collateral. Remaining heart diseases having a collateral producing continuous murmur is somewhat rare. Okay, go ahead. I think Dayasagar Rao sir is looking at me and time is not there.
Yeah, I got another 5 more minutes. That's all.
Please go ahead.
Show the other imaging.
It's a transthoracic echocardiogram, four chamber view, apical four chamber view, showing a normal. Actually, there is a mild right atrium and right ventricular dilatation is there. Mild TR is there, and at five chamber view, we can see very clearly that there is a large malaligned outlet VSD. The aortic valve is normal, sir. The aortomitral continuity is there, sir. Here, the short axis, external short axis view showing ventricular cut at biventricular mid biventricular level, showing that there is a decreased ventricular function.
But there is a hypertrophy is there, which is important finding here.
Yes, biventricular hypertrophy is there. Yes. So it's a parasternal long axis view, showing there is a large outlet VSD. The aortic wall appears normal, sir. There is a LSVC is there, and the ventricular septum appears thickened here. Color flow across the LVOT area shows the no aortic regurgitation. It's a parasternal short axis view showing a single vessel and the RVOT is complete. There is a pulmonary atresia is there. And there is a steam, we can see there is a controlled branch PH, the LPA and RPA which have been measured. LPA was around 8 meter and RPA was...
But how you can tell it's a branch, because it may be collateral also, no?
Yes, sir. Like, okay.
Yes, sir. To tell you the color and that. Okay.
Yeah.
True. So what is your diagnosis now, final diagnosis?
Sir, it's a VSD, a large... right ventricle. There is a mild tricuspid regurgitation, mild mitral regurgitation, large perimembranous VSD with pulmonary atresia, with confluent branch PS, hypoplastic branch PS, and ventricular dysfunction. No effusion.
Collateral.
With collateral. Collateral were not clearly seen with echo evaluation, sir. But the previous CT scan images we have, sir. That are this CT image is a coronal cut at the mid at the lungs level, showing left-sided descending aorta, and there are a significant two collaterals which can be seen. One is from here and one is from here, supplying to the right lungs. This is a sagittal cut of CT film, showing there is another collateral which is at the position of the duct. Maybe duct or collateral, we are not really sure, sir. There is LSVC and...
How can you tell that maybe it is a collateral or duct, not sure? In a CT scan, in a pulmonary atresia condition, the duct is vertical. The duct comes under surface of the aorta. This is the normal ductal location, and it is... Takeoff is different, so it has to be collateral. Okay.
And the doctors will be relatively long. The doctors will be relatively long.
Dr. Nageshwara Garu?
Sir, I got one question.
I want to ask one question to him.
Satyamurthy sir is asking question.
Yeah, okay. So after looking at the echo and after looking at the X-ray, how do you explain the absence of Q-wave in V5, V6? Hello.
Yes, sir.
And you saw the X-ray, ECG, echocardiogram, two ventricles, and the CT scan showing large collaterals.
Yeah, but how do you explain
ECG
the
also showing high voltages?
Maybe if he goes to V7, V8, V9, he might find a Q wave. Because
no. It's very unusual to have such a large R wave and still not have a small Q wave. And here is a patient where, you know, we are still don't have an explanation for a large QRS complex or the R wave in V5, V6, other than saying that we large collateral pulmonary backflow. But that still does not explain why the Q wave is absent in this patient V5, V6.
I think by scoliosis here, kyphoscoliosis, the interventricular septal plane may be a little bit altered also.
Correct.
Probably we need to
take that to me may not be really acceptable, because echocardiographically we have seen that the anatomy is not grossly distorted.
Yeah.
Only the heart cardiac silhouette is shifted a little to the left. But the anatomy will not be shifted. The RV will be anterior.
But it depends upon the plane of the interventricular septum.
No, echocardiogram.
Yeah, you saw two atria, two ventricles, two AV, only one seminal wall. And the plane of the septum posteriorly absolutely as usual in any other normal person. Yeah.
The thing is,
if you look at the chest X-ray, the heart is like this. The heart is like
this. But exactly. But
that doesn't alter the anatomy. There is HRV relation is okay. Septum is there. So the septal vector has to go to the left.
But the electrical electrical potentials may vary when it is there. But the
vector what I mean to say, whether V7, V8 may
Pick up Q wave.
Pick up Q wave. That is what I want to tell.
But V6 has already shown a very... Okay, forget about
that. Last one question. One question and one helpful tip to the student. Only two. Otherwise, where is that candidate? Doctor, you are online?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Yeah. Last question.
Any other thing to have apart from these images?
Sir, we have a cath angiogram, cardiac angiogram.
Okay, you want to show that?
Yeah.
Quickly.
Going faster.
Yeah. Yes. It's a pictal angiogram done in AP view. The course of the catheter is from the femoral artery to the descending aorta. So the contrast is filling descending aorta, which is on the left sided, normal situated aorta. We can see there are two major collaterals which are supplying confluent branch PS, and one collateral which was predominantly supplying to the right upper lobe of the lungs, and the another collateral is supplying to the left middle and left lower lobe. And we can also see that there is a retrograde filling of the native pulmonary arteries, which are almost like adequate size.
For the benefit of the postgraduates who are not very familiar with the angiogram, especially pediatric angiogram, which majority of the postgraduates may not be familiar, the approach should be like this. It is an angiogram, retrograde angiogram using pictal catheter, injection done just below the aortic arch, which opacifies both pulmonary vasculature. So that is the way they have to start. How can the aortic injection vascularize both the pulmonary arteries? So it means that there is an aortopulmonary collateral. This is what they should know. Then they will ask which are the collaterals, where it is joined, type of collaterals. Because many postgraduates are not familiar with angiogram.
But Satyamurthy sir wanted to speak some question or tip. Can you please?
Sir, any more angios are there or over?
Sir, completed, sir.
Actually, when you do the angio, you must do the ascending aorta also. Sometimes the collaterals can come from ascending aorta.
Arch.
It can come from mammary arteries, yes, arch.
Carotid arteries.
Completion, you must have ascending aorta also, number one.
Yes, sir. We have that.
Hello.
Fine.
Hello.
Just for completion. The question is, there is a spectrum. One side is tetralogy of Hallow. And in the extreme spectrum of conotruncal anomalies is transversion. Why you don't get to see so many collaterals in transversion? One side tetralogy, in between there is double outlet right ventricle. And the third side is extreme is transversion. Why you don't see autopulmonary collaterals in transversion?
Sir, there are the chances of incidence of collateral in DTG also with almost around 8 to 10%.
Yeah, Kalyan, that is not the question. You are talking rare. Question is very specific. I am very much impressed with that. Pulmonary atresia, VST, two ventricles, aorta is arising from the left ventricle, that is predominantly, that is called as tetralogy of Hallow, pulmonary atresia will have collaterals in most of the cases if it is a non-ducted ventilation. Otherwise, single ventricle, pulmonary atresia, syntax septum, tricuspid atresia, a kind of DTG, VST, PS, unlikely they will have collateral. You are talking rare 5% or 2% of cases. That is not the answer. He is asking very specific question. Sir, is it correct, sir?
Embryology of the pulmonary atresia VST is quite earlier. So, it is a late event where the persistence of the bronchial vessels, which will later on present as a aortopulmonary collaterals in the future time in VST pulmonary atresia as compared to the other conditions.
You have confused me.
No, the thing is,
okay, Nayeshwar, or anything more? You know, we...
No,
I think, yes, sir.
Many times.
Am I audible?
You are audible. You are audible. Okay.
Yeah, suddenly I got the sound. I was seeing the screen only. Okay. I heard the talk. Yeah, is it really confluent or is there a stenosis in between? Our pulmonary arteries both, this, you know, for surgical correction, it is a very important point. And collaterals can come also from innominate artery, even from subclavian, because embryologically that is all possible. So this much injection is not enough.
Yeah, we discussed.
I think between RPA and LPA, there is a narrowing.
Yes, sir.
So I think that that has to be corrected. And, you know, while correction is not an easy surgery, in stages it has to be done. No, while running you can see, because one injection in the MAPCA showing only the LPA well.
Yeah.
Otherwise it should have, dye should have gone on to the left side also. So selectively there's a MAPCA injection.
I would like to get a clarification from the panelists regarding the question raised by Dr. Satyamurthy. Why aortopulmonary collaterals are infrequent in DTG, all those things. To me, one of the answer was they do not survive for a longer time. Exactly. And collaterals develop over time.
Exactly. I agree. That is one of the major causes.
Any other thing, sir?
Second thing, in autopsy series, they showed some amount of collaterals, but before they grow, these children will perish.
Yeah, that's it. So survival is less. Collaterals develop over time, progressive.
Okay. But rare, very rare. Last is one tip to the candidate. When you are presenting, if any unimportant symptom or clinical finding is there, keep it aside. Means like chest pain. If you are unable to explain it, don't tell the examiner there's chest. Just avoid it. That's very important. Sometimes even we can't correlate some of the non-specific symptoms. There's one tip I can give to the candidate. He has presented very well, and we had a very good discussion. So that one tip I want to give to him.
Okay, Nageshwar.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much.
Do we have your talk now? Can we have
Arlian, can you please stop sharing your screen? Yes,
okay. Jain ji, welcome.
Sir.